The first game in the round of 16 for the WCS, aka World Championship for BFME 2, the Rise of the Witch King 2.02, with a cash prize of $500, between Khamul from Lugansk against Ahwehawe from Turkey, Isengard against Mordor on the beautiful map Plains of Linden, boys. The first game, let's get it started. So, at the top side of the map, we have the blue Isengard player Khamul, who was pre-picking his faction against the red Mordor player Ahwehawe, who was picking random, by the way. He's gonna start with two slaughterhouses, and we will have two furnaces at the top side, so nothing too crazy, nothing too spicy. It's a great map, one of my favorite maps actually in the 1v1s, and I'm happy that we will be getting this map first in the best of 5 series. So we will have two furnaces into the work pit start, interesting. So he's gonna get those work packs on the field first, I'm assuming. Eye of Sauron will be used from the Turkish player Ahwehawe to scout his opponent here. So he will be able to see this work pit. Maybe he can actually go for Haradrim Palace himself, but that's not gonna be the case. He's gonna start with an orc pit instead. Plains of Linden is actually including four creeps. Two of them are trolls at the bottom right side, at the top left side, and two of them are warglayers at the left side and at the right side, and we have also two ends as neutral structures to capture. He might also go for the upgrade first, because the upgrade for the work pit level 2 is actually quite cheap, but I'm assuming he's gonna get those units first on the field, because they are way cheaper, they cost only half amount of the work riders. And we're gonna have a Haradrim Palace coming up now for the Mordor player Ahwehawe, because you want to get those Easterlings on the field really fast. Because again, Mordor is pretty weak early on. And unless you are going to use those trolls, they are very strong. But spoiler alert, they're going to get nerfed next patch. So you need to actually already start thinking about some new strategies, besides only relying on the mountain trolls. So we have black normal orcs actually. I mean, we can also see maybe some black orcs later on. Work packs are coming in a 1v1 situation. Obviously, the work packs are gonna be able to win. My orcs are invisible. Maybe his asset actually is kind of broken, so we might be forced to remake the game. He can see his orcs, I think. Can we abort after this game? Yes, we can. Yes, we can. After this game, we can abort. It would be always nice to check everything if your game is working and if everything is already set up before we actually start with the World Championship, you know? Alright, we're gonna have whole ability being used on those work packs. So they will be taking down this furnace here or the slaughterhouse here. And orcs are being sent forward, the invisible orcs, but only for Ahwehawe. Uruk pit is on the fields now, we're gonna get some crossbowmen for defense, which should be more than enough to deal with those orc warriors. Not a big deal. Easterlings on the field, but a little bit too late because the slaughterhouse has been taken down already. Beautiful. On the other side, we have some orcs around the top left side, around this area as well. But again, you know, one by one, they're not gonna be very effective. And you can see they are pretty much getting one-shotted here. And they won't be able to deal any economical damage to the Isengard's player, Khamul, who was already able to take down one of those slaughterhouses from his opponent. Haradrim Palace level 1, Orc Pit is also level 1. Now, and he might also go for the transition into the troll cage, because again, this is still the version 8.3 in which trolls are hitting like an absolute truck. Isengard on the bright side is untouched for now at least. That might change pretty much with the next attack, but Eye of Sauron normally opens for the industry, so most of the time when we see Eye of Sauron start from a Mordor player, you know, he most likely gonna save for 10 and go for the industry power spike. But what you can always obviously do as well is collect 5 power points and go for the war chant for a double buff action. Ahwehawe is creeping the troll lair at the bottom right side, and the Isengard player from Lugansk, Khamul, is gonna creep the war lair at the right side of the map. War packs, they shouldn't be able to do much anymore because we have some orc archers on the field. They are getting protected by those Easterlings, but they might be able to take down this slaughterhouse here. And they could potentially even steal the treasure, but they are not paying attention, and obviously they don't have vision as well. So Mordor is gonna capture this in, which is gonna give him the option to get those Haradrim spearmen on the field. You know, they are pretty similar to the Haradrims from the Battle for Middle-earth 1. They are ranged, but they are still good against Cav. And Ahwehawe was also able to creep this work layer at the left side of the map. So, I mean, Troll, you know, even though Khamul was able to creep this work layer, but remember, the Troll layer is much more rewarding. You get, obviously, much more treasure from creeping a Troll layer other than creeping a work layer. Khamul might also go for the creep here at the top left side with those crossbowmen, but he needs to deal with those units first. And the positioning here is gonna be very important. You wanna make sure that your Urukai are the units who are tanking the damage, as crossbowmen are glass cannons and they will be taken down super fast. Porcupine formation to get enough resistance to actually stall. And for now, Isengard's player will be forced to retreat, but luckily, he will be able to save his level 2 pikemen. Mordor, after losing one of those slaughterhouses early on, is pretty much untouched for now, which is pretty nice. And Mordor is already scaling quite nicely after creeping two layers. Has almost 4 power points collected already, 500 command points available against 450 command points from Khamul, who has more power points collected than his opponent. But he might lose this furnace, and that's gonna be the case. Nice clamping here from the Turkish player Ahwehawe in the furnace, which was almost level 2, has been taken down. That's actually huge. You know, offense is the best defense. Isengard player will be going now for the War Chant. By the way, Isengard also started with the Creebane because he was starting with the Warg Packs. The Warg Pit is level 2 now, and we have some Warg Riders on the field. The first one is joining the battlefield and already using the Oil Ability for dealing with those Orcs, which might not be necessary, and he could have saved it maybe for damage on the other side of the map instead. Warg Packs, what I don't like about them is the fact that if you send them out one by one, they won't deal the damage you are looking for. And they actually will need a lot of time. And look who is here, boys. We have a Troll Cage and the first Mountain Troll is already joining the battlefield. Pretty damn good. 450 command points for Isengard, 450 command points for Mordor. Mordor actually went for the War Chant for the double buff action, so he has leadership plus, you know, buff, and they buff stack, so you can actually make even those orcs, Easterlings or whatever, much, much stronger. Nice pressure here from the Isengard player, the Slaughterhouse, and the Builder has been taken down as well. That's actually huge. Very well done here from Khamul. The Slaughterhouse is gonna get bursted down. The Inn is gonna get captured as well, which is pretty nice. But Mordor player Ahwehawe is preparing himself for a big counterattack. For a big counter push. Let's see how much damage he will be able to deal. We have 475 command points against 525, but this attack might actually change everything. This furnace here in the front is unprotected and should be taken down uncontested. The Slaughterhouse here is gonna be taken down, and it looks like they're gonna go for a base trade, but there is a Troll on the field now. And the thing is that he has only one pikeman, and once those pikemen are dead, this Troll can clean up. The furnace is going down, the Troll is running over the trees. That's how strong he is, actually. War Chant is gonna be available, Eye of Sauron is gonna be available at the same time, pretty much, in about 5 to 10 seconds, as we see Charku joining the battlefield from the Isengard player. There we go, War Chant has been used. Look the damage now, even those weak orcs, they have such a crazy damage output with the aggressive stance and the double buff. War Chant being used defensively on one pikeman only, which is very interesting actually. He's gonna use the Creebane, which is gonna nullify the enemy leadership here. That means the Eye of Sauron is gonna be absolutely pointless. The Troll is getting chased down by Sharku, and that shows you how to deal with them. But, oh, never mind the Fortress, because he almost made it to the Orcs and could heal up again. This Troll is gonna take down this level 2 furnace. I mean, Sharku is gonna damage him a little bit, but it's not gonna be, you know, very effective. Obviously, you need to hit him multiple times, while the Troll is dealing massive amount of damage to this level 2 furnace. And Isengard now lost a lot, has only 475 command points, but also lost... what is attacking me? he also lost the Warg Pit level 2. That means... sorry. Because his impression is actually golden, I like it. We have another Builder joining the battlefields now. That means no more Warg Riders any soon for Khamul. 8 power points collected though, so that means he's only 2 power points away from a Devastation. Devastation can actually help him out very nicely, as it gives you instantly resources, which you can use to get a hero like Lurtz on the field, or to expand and make more units at pretty much the same time. But the motor player has also 7 power points collected, and we know industry... Oh, never mind, he's gonna go for the tainted land. So this motor player is not playing, you know, defensively at all. He's like, you know what, I'm gonna prove you guys wrong, this Mordo is weak early on, because my Mordo is strong. He's gonna get more trolls on the field, Black Orcs actually from the level 2 Orc Pit, Easterlings are joining the battlefield as well, but there are so many crossbowmen. Tainted Land will be used, it's gonna be a buff, 50% increased damage and 50% increased armor for the Mordo units. Isengard is making the right choice and disengaging from the Tainted Land. Because as soon as those units are leaving the Tainted Land, the buff is not gonna be, you know, effective anymore, obviously. Unlike a buff like from Warchant, for example. Sharku, oh, Devastation has been used. Let's see how much money he was getting. A lot. Actually, look at this. He has now over 2,000 resources collected. Sharku is hitting level 3. He has enough money for the Lurts. But I feel like he needs to make some more units. He's gonna go for the second Uruk Pit and going for the Lurts at the same time. So Lurts is on his way. And we know... Heroes in the late game, they have such a big impact, boys. They have such a big impact. Sharku is fighting for the map control. The slaughterhouse might be taken down slowly but surely. He's getting more and more experience. They have 3 battalions of crossbowmen here. Ready to defend against those. That's the units, by the way. Haradrim Spearmen, they are called from this inn at the bottom right side. The troll and the only creep at the top left side is still remaining. As the second Uruk Pit is coming up, it looks like he doesn't want to go for the Warg Pit anymore. Which might be actually nice, because as far as I can see, he has 0 Warg Riders on the field anymore. So it looks like he's fully committing on the infantry units instead. Even though I feel like that 1 or 2 Warg Riders for the mobility, and especially with Sharku being around with the leadership, could be actually nice. Alright, the furnace has been taken down. Kreebane is gonna be used actually defensively once again, which is kind of questionable from Khamul here. I feel like it was not very necessary, because the most of the units were dead already, and he would have won this fight anyway. So kind of ditching out your buffs and debuffs for a fight which is already decided doesn't seem right for me. An Isengard player is gonna creep this last creep on the map Plains of Linden at the pretty much the same time. And he might capture this inn afterwards and get those Black Orcs on the field. And, you know, this inn here might work like a potential second barracks. And he would have, like, you know, pretty much 3 Uruk Pits now. The Black Orcs are a great alternative to the strong but also very expensive Urukai, who are chasing down those Easterlings. I would like to see the transition from the Mordor player, who has 550 command points available. He's going for the level 2 Haradrim Palace, because he knows... Isengard has so many crossbowmen on the field, but most of the time they are unprotected. So those Haradrim Lancers, they can do such a big work here. For example, this Urukai level 2, unprotected, he has pretty much no pikemen around. And that's gonna be a fiesta now. The trample is incoming. He has pikemen here now for this one crossbowman, but those 2 crossbowmen, they have to disengage, even 3 battalions. All they got is like a Black Orc. Now the first pikeman is coming. But this is gonna be already devastating. Even though he might get slowed down here, and that's gonna be the case, still decent amount of damage dealt, and he has now 10 power points unlocked. Lancers are disengaging, but they are dying actually very fast. And Lords just got level 2.5. The 10 power points could be invested for the industry, as you guys know. And because he's kinda behind still, and he would also need probably some of these Haradrim archers later on. And smart move, just sell them. But you don't have to sell them actually, because Mordor can capture this banner carrier from a level 1 Orc Pit, and it's quite cost efficient. Industry has been used on this level 3 slaughterhouse, so even though he's only at 650 command points, he should get enough resources now. Oh! What happened? Did he demolish his fortress? I think he did. And that's gonna be the game number 1. Khamul is 1-0 ahead after this game, guys. As we're gonna jump right into the game number 2. Alright, boys, after a questionable game number 1, we're gonna jump right into the game number 2. This time it's gonna be Goblins against Isengard on the map Westfold Edit, as Khamul is leading the Best of 5 series 1-0. But that's the beginning. And since it's Best of 5, you can always lose 1, even 2 games, and still be able to come back by winning 3 games in a row. At the left side of the map, we have the red goblin player Ahwehawe from Turkey. against the blue Isengard's player Khamul from Lugansk. I am pretty sure that's not the way you pronounce this country, but I gotta be honest with you guys, I've never heard about this country one time in my entire life. So that means I'm learning so much from being in the Rise of the Witch King community, which is pretty dope. Two furnaces against two tunnels. I'm assuming we're gonna see a lot of goblins first, but Spiderling Start could work pretty nicely on this map as well, because this map is, you know, kinda big. It's not that big like Jungles of Var'Harad, but having mobile units on a map like Westfold Jungles is always rewarding. That's why Isengard is gonna start the same way like he did in the previous game against the Moro faction. He's gonna start with a Warg Pit and gonna get those Warg Packs first before he makes the transition into the Uruk Pit. So two furnaces, Warg Pit into the third furnace. Two tunnels, Goblin Cave into the third tunnel. And the second Goblin Cave is coming up at pretty much the same time. So, this Warg Packs, I don't like them. I mean, I know many of you guys might like them, but if I have to choose, I would always prefer the Spiderlings or even the Dire Wolf Packs, you know? Because I feel like they can't trample anything, and they are kind of very squishy. They die pretty fast against any damage, by the way. And they are kind of comparable, you can kind of compare them a little bit actually with something like Spiderlings, but Spiderlings are much stronger than them against Calf, against Soldiers. I think the only unit they are very strong, or they are kind of stronger against, is our Archers actually. And that's why I would always prefer Spiderlings over the Warg Packs. He's gonna move through the bot side. It looks like you wanna go for the creep first at the bottom right. On the other side, we have this. The Uruk Pit is coming up now after three furnaces, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, he has three resource buildings. And Ahwehawe has now still only two Goblin Caves. So he might skip the third Goblin Cave and make the transition into the Fissure or Spider Pit. Goblin Warriors are coming from the top right side. But the Warg Packs, they should be able to see them. Now they are able to see them. And I feel like they need to go back because they don't have any protection. As the Crossbowmen, they will still need some time to join the battlefield. You have two Goblin Warriors coming from this angle as well. All abilities being used. And he's gonna go for this tunnel. It looks like he was not able to see that. But he will be able to see this one. But Goblin Warriors are coming. And that's why, you know, you gotta love goblins and dwarves on maps like this. Because you think like, oh my god, I see a tunnel, I'm protected. But you think wrong most of the time, because this tunnel kinda has like 5 goblin warriors inside. They're gonna come out of nowhere and then you will be like, oh my god, what I'm gonna do now? Alright, bad positioning here with the crossbowman, but it looks like Ahwehawe is not gonna commit. He was still buying some time and Khamul is gonna let this wall hub build. I mean, it's not terrible, because it's gonna give you vision. Sainrong, thank you so much for the tier 1 sub, appreciate that. Really means a lot to me, thank you for the sub and for the follow. And Brown Bear with 17 riders. I hope you had a great stream, Brown Bear, and everyone welcome to the stream, guys. That's the game number 2 between Ahwehawe against Khamul, and Khamul is 1-0 ahead. 350 command points, we have for the Isengard's player against 450 command points from the Goblin player Ahwehawe. The transition after two Goblin Keeps into the Spider Pit. But it's only level 1, so he's gonna go for the Spiderlings first. On the other side, two Crossbowmen for defense around this area. Which is not bad at all, because right now the Goblin player doesn't have anything to deal with those Crossbowmen. Again, those Spiderlings are very weak against Archers. But it looks like Khamul is actually struggling to deal the damage he's looking for, because every tunnel he's attacking, you know, more and more units coming out on the field pretty much at the same time. Warg Packs against Spiderlings, they are buffed against non-buffed units, and he's gonna go for the creeping now, which is gonna be used offensively. The Spiderlings are dying, but, you know, there are just too many goblins to deal with, and Khamul will be forced to disengage. As the Warg Riders are coming now, okay. That's a different story. All he needs to do now is deal with those Spiderlings, because they are gonna be a great counter against the Warg Riders. Kriven is still flying around to debuff them, and he's losing actually a lot of these Spiderlings for no reason. I mean, obviously he wanna protect this tunnel, but lost still many, many of these. Warcriders are forced to disengage. During all this time, we have some fights going on here at the bottom right side, and mispositioning from Khamul one more time. You don't want to be in melee range against those goblin warriors. That's why it's always nice to have some units you can put in front of them, so they have some protection. Because if they are low like this, and they are only level 1, they will become kinda useless. Nice trample here. He has still only 350 command points, so he doesn't even have the power points for the war chant, since he went for the cave bats. And Goblin player is just out spamming him big time. He's almost double his command points from his opponent, and big war chant play. He knows his opponent doesn't have buff or a debuff anymore, and he has now enough power points to go for the cave bats himself. So it's kind of a double buff action for the Turkish player Ahwehawe here, and he can dominate this fight absolutely kappa, because actually he's losing everything to those Warcriders, even though he was fully committing to that. So I take it back. And Khamul didn't even lose that much, you know. That's a proof. That's a proof that quality goes over quantity, boys. You know, it's not always who has the bigger army. You know, it's about who has the stronger army. Like think about Sparta, about the movie 300. You know, 300 soldiers against a full army of Persia. That's crazy. So we have 3 goblin caves now. A spider pit's level 2 actually for the spider riders. There is a tunnel at the bottom right side, and he's gonna use that for a potential attack. But Warchan and Cave Bats are still on cooldown, and he has 3 power points collected afterwards and 700 command points available without any barrow expansions around the fortress. Against 500 command points now, as Khamul was able to catch up. He has 2 level 2 furnaces. This one is also almost level 2. 5 power points collected, which might be used for the buff for the Warchan. But the problem is, he doesn't have that many units on the field. Like, you know, this attack pretty much happens right after the first attack. He's gonna go for the buff, but there is no unit to buff at this point. Like, he has nothing here. The first army from those Warcriders is coming now. They don't have to be buffed because they have whole ability. The pikemen are fighting against goblin warriors, and this fight is benefiting the goblin player big time. He's gonna be able to take down all the level 2 furnaces from the Isengard's player Khamul, who is gonna be around 300 command points only after losing this level 2 furnace. And not only that, but also the amount of power points he was gaining from this attack was actually quite nuts. He has 6 power points collected now, and that means he's only 4 power points away from, you know, summoning the Spider Elias, which can deal devastating amount of damage to the enemy resource buildings. This one is pretty low already. There is even a tower from Ahwehawe, by the way, at the bottom right side, and Isengard's player with this army only can't commit to that fight. 6 power points against 2 power points, so he has 4 power points advantage against his opponent, and he has almost double the command points from his opponent. And I said it 1,000 times, I'm gonna say it 1,000 more times actually. Goblins and Dwarves are two factions in Rise of the Witch King you don't want to be behind against, you know. Because once you are behind against those factions, they will attack you all the time. Bursmat for the tier 1 3 months, welcome back. Hope you're gonna enjoy your stay. Thank you so much for that, man. Appreciate that.
Bursmat just means a lot to me. For 3 months. Ahoy.
Alright, boys. So he's gonna have the control of this side of the map. And Isengard will be kinda under constant pressure. And, you know, he's also sending units to the other side of the map. All he needs to do now is kind of make a sandwich move, right? Attack him from all the 3 possible pathways at once and force him to split the army. Maybe it's not a smart move to look for an all-out fight against Isengard, because we have seen before that Isengard can even win those fights with less units. But he's committing now with a lot of goblin warriors, boys. Like, oh, I mean, that's a crazy amount of goblin warriors. And they have the passive ability, which is called Horde Bonus. With that being said, they are dealing 25% increased damage. Spider Riders are coming, all they gotta do is wait until the pikemen are gone. And then you can trample down. And they can even take down those Warcriders, by the way, with the bows. Because they are very strong against them, they are not even buffed. And this attack is gonna be very hard to defend. But you know, that's not even all, because he's attacking from the middle at the same time, and the Spider Elias. Good tower. Game is gonna be over, and the score after the game number 2 is gonna be even now, boys. Khamul 1 and the Turkish player Ahwehawe also won. Pretty nice. Alright boys, the first tiebreaker game, the game number 3, is all about to happen on the beautiful map Jungles of Far Harad. Random against Isengard turns to be Mordor against Isengard one more time. We had this exact the same matchup in the game number 1, which Ahwe lost, but Ahwe had some visual problems as he was not even able to see his orcs. And I think that's gonna be a different story now. Let's see. Two furnaces potentially, and I feel like warg packs are gonna be a great choice also on this map. On the other side, we will have two slaughterhouses, and you don't have to rush our orc pits here. I think you can make like 3, even potentially 4 slaughterhouses first, before you have to make your first production building. The reason is because the distance between the bases, between this fortress and this fortress, is so long that attacking very early is gonna be very difficult. So even if you make multiple slaughterhouses first, by the time this Urukai gonna arrive at your side of the map, you will have some defense anyway. And that's exactly what he's doing, by the way. He's building 3 slaughterhouses and going even for the number 4. Eye of Sauron is gonna be used for the scout, so he is able to see those 2 furnaces and the Uruk pit. Now Khamul has some different choices. He can go for the pikeman and go for the creep, which would be a very passive but a safe playstyle. But he can also go for the Urukai and go for the push. Since he's starting with the pikeman, I'm assuming he's gonna go for the creep first. Again, this is the safer way. This way you can get some more money from the map, you get a level 2 pikeman, you get some power points, and then you can still group them with your Urukai and go for a push with Urukai and pikeman combo. That's a possibility as well. So 2 orc pits are coming up at the same time for the Turkish player Ahwehawe, who was able to win the previous game. And on the other side, another furnace at the bottom left side. Pikemen, let me see where they are gonna go. They're gonna go for this creep here. That's their waypoint, as you can see. And I think the next unit are gonna be those Urukai potentially, or some crossbowmen even. Yeah, that's gonna be the case. Khamul is playing surprisingly defensively now, because if you are going for the crossbowmen second, you will be most likely using them for defense. And I feel like that's not very necessary. What he could potentially do is go for the Urukai, group them with the pikemen after you are creeping. And you know that he was starting with the Eye of Sauron. That means he won't have his leadership back
once you are ready to attack.
Then you have no buff. I mean, he didn't pick anything just yet, but he can go for the war charm and then, you know, make those units very strong. But I mean, he's gonna choose to play the safer way, which makes sense. It's a cash-priced tournament after all, so you don't wanna take any unnecessary risk in this best of 5 series. Okay, we have some pikemen in the middle and orcs here. They will be able to see each other, and no one is capturing the signal fire just yet. They have 400 command points for Isengard and 400 command points for Mordor. Mordor having a fantastic time, being untouched for now. As an orc pit level 2 and even a troll cage up on the field, and the first mountain troll is already all about to join the battlefield, which is pretty nice. Okay, so he needs multiple crossbowmen now, and he needs even pikemen to protect them against this troll. And all of that is happening because, you know, Mordor was pretty much untouched until now. Maybe starting with the Urukai and going for the attack early on would be the better choice, but again, Khamul is not able to see the stuff that we are able to see. We have orcs here. And that's gonna be the first push, I'm assuming. Did he go for the war chant? That's the question. Eye of Sauron is already back up, so can be used for defense. There is already a troll on the field who might be able to commit to that fight, but there are some pikemen he needs to avoid fighting. That's why you can always pick up a rock and act like an archer. I mean, I like the, you know, I like the troll and like battle wagons a lot, because you can use them in so many different ways, and which makes them kind of impossible to counter, right? If you think about it, when you grab a rock and there is a fight, a big fight happening, and you are smashing with the rock all the time on these units, what's the matter if he has pikemen? No, it doesn't do anything. Warchan pick, by the way, from Khamul, which will be used now. The slaughterhouse has been taken down. The builder has to be careful here from the Mordor player Ahwehawe, and the Warcrabbers are coming just in time. There are no Easterlings around, but they're getting slowed down big time That's why you don't want to trample like this. That's the worst possible trample and the worst possible outcome here for the Isengard player Khamul. And the reason why it's so bad is actually not. This troll is chasing down those Warcribers for some reason, as he should actually focus on the furnaces instead. But the Warcriber trample did absolutely nothing besides giving power points to the model player Ahwehawe. And he will be able to defend himself. I mean, what I'm trying to say is, when there is a large, you know, a big army from your opponent, you don't want to run into the middle of the enemy unit. Because that's gonna make you get slowed down, unless you have Glorious Charge, then you can afford to do that. And then you're gonna stuck in between these units, and you will take a lot of damage while you yourself are dealing zero damage in exchange, which is really bad. But it's not the end of the world. The furnace has been taken down. The troll is also putting a lot of pressure. Level 2 might die here to the Oh no. So unfortunate for the Isengard player Khamul here, because the Mordor player is gonna just say, yum, 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 yum. Looks like, you know, meat is back on the menu, boys. Oh! Oh my goodness, this troll. That's really unfortunate for the Mordor player this time, because, you know, when you eat the orc, obviously, after eating, you know, you are the same, I'm the same. We need to rest. Like, you can't eat and then go for the attack immediately. You will need some time, you know, to actually enjoy the meat. And while he was enjoying the meat, he got taken down. Pretty unfortunate for the Mordor player, Ahwehawe. 6.5 power points collected from Isengard. I'm assuming he's gonna go for the devastation one more time, because he has only 350 command points available and his resource income is not looking that great. On the other side, we have 450 command points for the Mordor player, Ahwehawe, who has 5 power points collected, which will be used for the War Chant. Remember, the Eye of Sauron is still on cooldown, but War Chant is gonna be ready for the next fight. We have Orc Archers and Black Orcs on the field. You know, don't underestimate them. They are pretty strong. Okay? This troll has to be careful, and Black Orcs are a great and solid choice in this situation. Why? Because they are a great choice against the Uruk-hai Pikeman units. You have my sword. Balmung1, thank you so much for the follow and welcome to the stream. Thank you so much. Hope you're gonna enjoy your stay. Alright, the Warcriders are coming. Nice trample here, but the Black Orcs are not even getting one-shotted. Even with the Kribane flying over them, actually. That's how strong they are in compared to normal Orcs. That's a different story this time, because he has 2 battalions of units. That means the damage is very nice. Alright, I think he lost another troll here. Never mind, the troll is still alive, almost level 2. But he needs to be careful now, because he's getting chased down all the time. Sharku could be a great choice here. And because of the Kribane, Khamul is gonna be far away from the devastation. Another mountain troll is joining the battlefield and will be chasing down those Warcriders, so they won't be able to take down this level 2 slaughterhouse, I'm assuming. And even if they try, it would be a very risky commitment, as they clump big time, and the first attack from the troll can be actually very devastating. The slaughterhouse here will be taken down as well. 450 command points for Isengard. Mordor has 575 command points available. These trolls are doing work, ladies and gentlemen. And Isengard needs to get some money elsewhere. He needs to fight for the map control. He needs to go for the creeps, because now it's gonna be difficult for him to actually deal the damage when he's being chased down like this all the time. That's why a hero like Sharku Lurtz is always gonna be a great choice. Because then you can support these Warcriders with leadership, and then you have also some damage you can use against these trolls. Mordor is creeping the Warclay at the bottom left side as well. These trolls are still doing a lot of work here alongside the map. We have a level 2 Warg Pit and a level 1 Uruk Pit, and the second Uruk Pit is coming up now for the Isengard player Khamul. 600 command points, and Mordor is doing a great job, not by only harassing his opponent, but also by keeping his side of the map kind of safe with a great use of those mountain trolls. Mr. Balin, thank you so much for the follow and welcome to the stream. Hope you're gonna enjoy your stay, buddy. 7 power points for Isengard. 550 command points. 600 command points for Mordor and 4 power points. I mean, on the bright side for Isengard's player Khamul, he's ahead in terms of power points. But again, that can change literally in 5 seconds. As long as those trolls are remaining on the field, Khamul has to be very patient, very careful. In this situation, you can split them, because as you can see, many of these units are not able to attack. That means if you wanna, you know, kind of use your mobile units for the map control fights, you know, splitting them 2x2 is the way to go. in my opinion. Frostbowmen are not dealing any damage here to this troll, by the way. I mean, any damage is a wrong statement, but not enough damage. I think that's the right thing. And the crossbowmen are coming from the Uruk pit, and I get smashed down immediately. Eye of Sauron is being used, and the three production buildings here might be in trouble. The builder is gonna be used to build a work sentry here. I don't know about that. Even the Uruk pit is getting attacked. The crossbowmen and pikemen are here, and the trolls are all over the place. And Mordo is actually showing how strong this faction can be if you are not being attacked early on. He has almost 9 power points collected, 650 command points available against 650 command points, but that's gonna be changed soon. And losing the work pit level 2 means again, no more work riders any soon for the Isengard's player Khamul. And the Mordor trolls are still remaining on the field, level 2. And oh, nice micro here, by the way. Now he's watching everything, and that's how you wanna play Rise of the Witch King. That was like a half battalion of pikemen. He's watching, eating orcs now. No, over heal, by the way, this troll was already full health, but you know, you can't eat an orc with this one when his buddy is watching. That's not how friends are acting, you know, under each other. Work? Sentry is doing work actually here. Even against Easterlings, not bad at all. I mean, they might be able to protect this furnace here. Devastation will be picked and immediately used. Look at his money, boys. At some point, he was so close for the Saruman. He needs to definitely get a hero on the field or two. And Mordi is building a tower here in front of the furnaces from his opponent. 700 command points for Isengard. Devastation was helping him out a lot. And he has almost enough money for the Saruman, for the mighty wizard. On the other side, Mordo player has industry, building now the second Haradrim Palace. So he will have in total 5 production buildings, 2 orc pits, one of them is level 2, 2 Haradrim Palace, both level 1. And a troll cage level 1. 6 power points collected afterwards. The Uruk pit has been taken down, one of them. He has still one remaining on the field, but you can see, it's like one hit away from getting destroyed. This tower is gonna do a great job kind of defending this side. And, you know, it's a perfect place for the trolls to back up. The furnace is going down as well. And I can tell you, is Isengard's player getting a hero on the field? Because he is losing all his production buildings. That's the only Uruk pit he has, but he's not making any units. Macro gaming, yeah, he doesn't like the macro gaming, which is obviously required and necessary on big maps like Jungles of Far-Harad. Macro gaming in RTS games is at least as important as micro gaming. Now we have it being all around the place, expanding and putting pressure all the time. Having an amazing micro with those trolls. He lost like one troll, I think, all game long, which is amazing. You know, and it's not easy, actually, to defend yourself and be able to attack at the same time. I think that's the difference between a good player and a great player. Making sure to have always backup for the trolls to keep them alive against the Sharku. Sharku might be in trouble here. Look how much damage he's taking from this Easterlings. Oh my goodness, he's getting bursted down. Not even close, baby. And Sharku will be able to survive for now. But I can say the same thing about the Isengard faction in this game number 3. And this one is looking great for the Turkish player Ahwehawe. He might be able to get the lead after this game. Get the lead in the series doesn't mean the end of the series for Khamul, because he will have at least one more chance. After 2 big maps, and I think Khamul doesn't like to play on those big maps. And Forts of Isen is still available, so Forts of Isen would be definitely a great pick for Khamul for the next game, as the fortress is getting smashed down from those trolls with rocks. The range is crazy, actually. Even though I would say the damage from these trolls in melee form is a bit stronger than with the rocks, if I'm not mistaken. And slowly but surely, the fortress is getting taken down. He's even trying to build some expansions, but what's the matter? This is gonna change anything. Yeah, it changed actually anything, because it looks like they won't be able to attack the fortress when these wall hubs are building up. And for now, they will be forced to retreat, but the fortress is already so low. And all he needs to do is close his eyes, press Q to select all the units he has on the field, and right-click on the fortress. I think that's gonna be enough. Ooh. Oh no, Sharku. Was it Sharku even? Yeah, he was Sharku. I mean, chasing down those trolls. I mean, you have a warg to ride on. Those guys are trolls. Who you think you are, Sharku? How can you think that you can mess with this mighty Trolls of the Morrow faction? 9 power points collected, 650 command points for Isengard. Yes, still decent amount of money, but what's the matter if you can't have enough units or not the units you need to deal with those trolls fast enough? The fortress is going down and Khamul is gonna call it GG. That's gonna be the game number 3, and Ahwehawe will be only one win away from entering the quarterfinals. And Khamul has to win the next game, otherwise he will be dropping to the loser bracket. Ahwehawe versus Khamul, game 3. Pretty damn good, boys. Alright, boys, the game number 4, Isengard against Random one more time. Ahwehawe is only one win away from entering the quarterfinals alongside with Mr. Smok and King Mustafa. Those two players were already able to get to qualification games in the round of 6 in yesterday. And today, we're gonna get, for now, the third member in the quarterfinals. Possibly after this game, or at least, you know, after 2 games. We have the red Angmar player this time, the Turkish player Ahwehawe, who is leading 2-1 in the best of 5 series against the blue Isengard player, Khamul from Lugansk. 2 furnaces for Khamul and 2 mills for Ahwehawe on the beautiful map Holin Molin Edit. We have two work layers in the middle of the map, and then one here at the bottom right side and one at the top left side. And then we have 2 troll layers at the top right and at the bottom left side protecting those ints. Fluffy Brito, thank you so much for the follow and welcome to the stream. Hope you're gonna enjoy your stay. So we have again the same start from the Isengard player. 2 furnaces into the work pit. On the other side, we have 2 tree mills into the first Hall of the Kingsmen from the Turkish player Ahwehawe. Okay, so PowerPoint wise, I'm assuming Angmar is gonna go for the War Chant, and I think Zoe is gonna be the choice of the Isengard player Khamul, even though he can always start with the Cave Bats, but I feel like against Angmar, I mean, maybe he's gonna start with the Cave Bats anyway because of his War Packs and because of their Horde ability, so let's see. That's a risky move, I guess, against Angmar. He can easily counter that without building any other structure, because if he's patient enough, and if he's waiting with the Trial Masters, you can always wait. You don't have to transform them all the time immediately. You can always get them into the pikemen just in time. The Uruk pit is building up now after 3 furnaces. Pretty much the same start from Khamul all the time, regardless what the matchup is. He was doing the same start against Mordor. He was doing the same start against Goblins. And he's now doing the same start also against the Angmar faction from Ahwehawe, who is building his second Hall of the Kingsmen. Alright. Yeah, the Reddit is kind of rigged. I don't know what's wrong with Reddit. You are coming from Reddit here, Fluffy. Thank you so much for being here. Alright. So, Wunderbad Warrior starts from Ahwehawe. He's gonna creep this Warg layer in the middle of the map. The Warg packs on the other side from the Isengard player Khamul are moving through the bottom side. PowerPoint wise, still nothing picked and nothing chosen. Angmar player on the other side is starting with the famous War Chant. The buff is the most reliable power point ability from any faction in Rise of the Witch King. This mill is gonna be taken down. That's actually great. Nice one here from finding out this spot of this mill. But it's not the end of the world for Ahwehawe, because he's gonna get some money now from the creep. You get around 200 resources. Each treasure has around 100, like a little bit more, a little bit less, but from a creep, from a war creep, you most of the time are getting around 200 resources. Gotta be avoiding those pikemen very importantly. And again, you don't want to fight them in a situation like this. Oh, the Trollmaster, maybe you can snipe him down. I've never actually thought about that. But that could be always a possibility. 1 crossbowman only for defense. Let's see if this is gonna be enough, because he has the buff. And Isengard still didn't pick anything just yet. So he might be forced to buff those crossbowmen to burst down those Gundabad warriors. Pikemen are coming. Disengage now. It's so important to disengage now. Bring the pikemen in the front to body block those Gundabad warriors. That's a nice positioning now. Everything is gonna be different. Now he needs to retreat. There is a fortress shooting him down, and that's a perfect start into the game number 4 from the Isengard's player Khamul. Not only he was able to take down one of those mills, no, but he was also able to protect himself for now I think this is gonna be taken down because the work packs were not in position. But he's gonna kill like 3 battalions of Gundabad warriors. He's gonna get a lot of power points. And he on the other side didn't lose a single unit just yet. So unit advantage is at bare minimum as important as power point advantage in this game. If almost 2 power points collected, 400 command points available. 400 command points also available for the Angmar player Ahwehawe, who's gonna go for the second creep at the bottom right side and creeping the third work layer at the middle of the map as well. That's gonna be his third work layer, by the way, guys, against zero from the Isengard's player Khamul. That means macro is so much important in this game. This creep should be easily taken by the Turkish player Ahwehawe, and the treasure is gonna be secured by him as well. But the Thrallmaster, this one is so low. You see this health of the Thrallmaster, boys? Nah, there we go. That's the weakness of this unit. Because once you kill this Thrallmaster unit from the backside, you will lose the entire battalion. Work packs are coming. You need to avoid fighting those pikemen. But I think Khamul is now paying attention finally. You have some wolf packs joining the battlefield now from the Troll and Wolf Den. And they are so good when it comes to take down those Uruk pikemen. Even if they are in the porcupine formation, they are like one hit, 50% health from this pikeman is gone. They are so cheap, but yet so effective. Even against crossbowmen, look at this. They are dominating this fight. And that's the reason why I like them more than those work packs. Okay, this furnace is getting attacked as well. Angmar player Ahwehawe is proving that he can play with every faction, which is obviously always a great advantage in any matchup. Because if you are a one-trick player, your opponent gets the chance to train against the one specific faction all the time. And when you are, for example, playing only Angmar, he's gonna just train to play against Angmar only with a faction he thinks is a good pick against the faction Angmar. And then he has much higher chances to win against you. But when you are playing random and you are performing really nicely with every faction, we have much higher chance that you will be winning those series. He is putting a lot of pressure on the Isengard's player Khamul. Both players were able to qualify themselves from the group stage. Khamul and Imperialist were in the same group. Ahwehawe and Irby were in the other group. And next Sunday, in exactly 1 week from now, we're gonna have Irby against Imperialist, and in the following days we're gonna have more round of 16 games. So by the time, like not next week but 2 weeks after, we're gonna start with the quarterfinals, boys. So the winner of this tournament is gonna get $320. The second player is gonna get $120, and the third place will be rewarded with $60 in total. Which is pretty nice. Khamul has only 450 command points, and as an Angmar player, Ahwehawe has 550 command points collected. 7 power points available after Felwind and Warchant. 0 power points after Warchant and Kribane. Kribane is on cooldown, can't be used. But Warchant is gonna be available again. Khamul has the problem that he has buff available, but there are no units to buff. He has only 1 battalion of work packs and half of that battalion of those crossbowmen. Obviously, that's not gonna be enough to stop such a big force from the Turkish player Ahwehawe, who is playing incredibly well since the game on the number 1, actually, which he lost because he was having problems with his graphics. He couldn't see his units. Ahwehawe, a player from Battle for Middle-earth 2, you know, winning those series, those games against very experienced Rise of the Witch King players with his young age. And congratulations to the Turkish player Ahwehawe, who's gonna reach now the quarterfinals. But Khamul has still a shot. He can still make it even to the finals, but he needs to perform really nicely in the loser's bracket. Pretty nice, boys.